Carry that inside, ready is dynamite. Caribbean inside, really super was spite. Caribbean inside, enjoy day or night. Caribbean inside, really is dynamite.
It was Sunday, August 23rd, 1981, at Marcus Garvey Day Rally in Market Square, St. George's, Grenada. When Maurice Bishop declared that the revolution is under attack.
This is a good time for calling on the comrade leader to bring out the heavy roller. We're going to ask you to bring out the heavy roller.
An invasion is imminent. Welcome to CaribbeanInsideTV.com. I am Lady V. This mini-series, Maurice Saw Them Coming, exposes the United States' destabilization strategy.
All right, I believe the roller is coming. The roller is coming of the party, the revolution, and the government. And the Prime Minister, Comrade Bishop, will now address us, bringing out the heavy, heavy, heavy roller.
Beloved sisters and brothers, comrades of Free Grenada. Comrades, early on, when our party was discussing what I should speak about tonight, the plan was that I give a fairly long speech. But I believe that having regard to the fact that we have heard so much from so many of our friends tonight already, who have spoken on behalf of their organization, on behalf of their parties in the region, and also because, of course, it's getting late, but perhaps most importantly, because your fighting mood here tonight, comrades, your great numbers tonight here, your militancy, your revolutionary spirit tells me that words from the leadership are totally unnecessary. Our people are fighting. Our people are ready. Imperialism will learn a lesson if imperialism comes to our country.
Imperialism, no.
We are commemorating Marcus Garvey Day in our country. The comrades have pointed out that Marcus Garvey, when he led that struggle from Jamaica 35, 40 years ago, he was leading at the time an anti-colonial struggle, an anti-imperialist struggle, a struggle that was aimed at bringing benefits to the poor of Jamaica and the region. A struggle that was aimed at bringing justice to the common man. For his efforts, this Caribbean son, this Caribbean hero, was persecuted, was harassed, was prosecuted by the United States government. He was imprisoned not just for his belief, but for his great organizational ability. Today in our country, we can draw a parallel from the experience of the Marcus Garvey movement with our own movement in Grenada. We can see here too the persecution of our people, the harassment of our people, the slandering and defaming of our people, the attempt to try to demoralize and confuse our people, as we too are engaged now in another historic task of struggling against imperialism, of struggling for justice and for a new day, not just for our own people, but for the people of the Caribbean. Today, comrades, as we celebrate this Marcus Garvey Day, it is certainly one of the best possible occasions for us to speak about this great danger, this great threat which our country, our people, and our revolution are facing. There is absolutely no doubt about it at all that a revolution today is in danger. There is absolutely no doubt that very careful rehearsals have taken place in the past week by the United States Armed Forces, rehearsals which undoubtedly represent a trial run for an invasion of our beloved homeland. These rehearsals have seen put to work a plan of invasion, a plan of attack. These rehearsals have also seen practiced the actual excuses and pretexts and lies by which they hope to justify an invasion of our country to the world. Our revolution today is in danger. There can be no doubt about that. But before we go into details of that, comrades, I want to say a few words also on a question that other comrades before me have touched on already for the night. I too want briefly to try to attempt to answer the question, why have they singled out our poor, small country for an invasion? What is it about Grenada and the Grenada Revolution that excites and inspires and stimulates so much fear in the hearts of Reagan and his warlords in the United States? We have no great factories. We have no great banks in this country. We have no great raw materials. We have no oil, no gold. What is it that such a small country with so few natural resources can cause so much excitement and worry to this very big, powerful country a few miles away from us? Comrades, I think it is important for us in trying to come to the answer to realize first of all that there is one fact about our small country that today distinguishes us from every other English-speaking Caribbean country in this region, and that links us to only two other countries in this region. And that fact is that we, in small, tiny, but brave Grenada, led the first revolution in the English-speaking Caribbean. That is the first fact that we must observe, because in many respects, it is the most important fact. It is certainly the starting point for this analysis. Because one of the things that the Grenada Revolution has done has been to challenge the carefully built-up myths, the carefully built-up illusions that these people have tried to brainwash us with for hundreds of years. And that is that we are too small, we are too weak, We are too cowardly to challenge any dictatorship. That we are a people, as a Caribbean people, that the Americans can always rely on to take whatever licks that we are getting from our local dictator and never do anything about it. And when the Grenada Revolution came along and challenged this theory, it smashed one of the major illusions that they had spent dozens of years cultivating. And therefore, the example of the Grenada Revolution has become a subversive and dangerous example, because one of the things that this revolution now means is that it has demonstrated in practice and in real life that here is a small people in the English-speaking Caribbean that is brave enough and ready enough to take up arms to challenge the oppression, the resistance, and the dictatorship. A second factor that we must never forget is that this revolution in Grenada is not only a popular people's revolution, it is also a revolution that has set itself a historic task and a historic responsibility. The task of trying to develop in our country a new order, a new society for a new people that we are now in the process of constructing. Imperialism understands very well that the end result of what we are trying to build is the construction of a new civilization right here in the Caribbean. And that prospect also frightens them. They see when they look around that what is being constructed in our country is an alternative developmental model. A model that can challenge the existing developmental model that reigns right through the English-speaking Caribbean. They understand very well that a new socio-economic formation, the new democratic grassroots organization, the new approach to building the country, the new approach to involving the people and getting the people to participate, they understand that if that model is allowed to succeed, then other people in other islands will ask the question, how come little Grenada, with even less dollars than us, can bring free health care? How come little Grenada, with even less resources than we have, can bring free secondary education? How come little Grenada can bring programs to benefit the small farmers, programs to benefit the youth, to benefit the women? How come this small country that only 2 years ago was doing exactly the same like the rest of us is today well on the way towards constructing this new society? That question can be posed by the Caribbean masses, and that will be a dangerous question. A third factor, comrades, is that we must understand that the Grenada Revolution has embarked on a particular kind of foreign policy that the United States ruling circles find to be subversive and dangerous. The Grenada Revolution today is not going after the United Nations like in the days of Gary. I'm talking about unidentified flying objects. We are not now going around the world and trying to receive gifts and trying to sit at great dinners with leaders around the world and sell out our country and then come back home and boast about that. They understand that today the Grenada Revolution maintains a non-aligned policy in the world. They understand the significance of our joining the non-aligned movement. They understand the importance of our being elected as a member of the Bureau of the Non-Aligned Movement. They understand the importance of Grenada standing up in the world and saying, that we are not in anybody's backyard. That we have a right to build our own country in our own image and likeness and after a fashion and form that our people want. They understand what it means when the Grenadian Revolution says that the resources of our people will be used for the benefit of our people and not for the benefit of big, ligaroo, multinational corporations. They understand what all of that means, and they see that as dangerous to the survival of the system of imperialism, a worldwide system, that has been exploiting the third world developing countries for dozens and dozens of years. They see that challenge from the Grenada Revolution. These people over there have also looked at our revolution and have made the analysis, which is a correct analysis, that the Grenada Revolution is comprised of a country made up of people of largely African descent, a people who are predominantly black-skinned, a people who belong to what can be described as a black country. That also means something to the United States imperialists, because they have in captivity in their own country millions and millions of black people who are being oppressed every day, who are suffering from racism every day, and who therefore are able to develop instinctively and automatically a relationship, a rapport, a dialogue, a feeling with and for our people who are leading this revolution in Grenada. The imperialists understand that also. They are talking about it in their secret documents. They have also made the analysis, and therefore we must notice also that the Grenada Revolution is the only one of the three revolutions in the Caribbean that speak English. The Cuban Revolution and the Nicaraguan Revolution, their people speak Spanish. That is their first language. And therefore there is that little bit more difficulty in achieving a certain measure of communication with the people of the United States. But any time a tourist lands in this country, regardless of which Grenadian he or she speaks to, immediately one important means of communication is well established. That one dealing with the question of language. They have identified that fact in their secret documents also. These people have also pointed to the fact that the location of our country, right here to the north of Trinidad and Tobago, is a very strategic location. They have been saying that the oil that has to travel to the United States, the bauxite that has to travel to the United States, that much of it has to pass very close to our little country. That the sea lanes that these great ships have to use, the routes that they have to follow, happen to fall right next door to where our country is geographically situated. And therefore they feel and they have drawn the conclusion that their oil and their bauxite requires a country that is nearby that they can fully control and fully dominate and fully tell what to do. It is almost as if these people are telling us that they want us to lift up our country and put it somewhere in Africa, or put it somewhere in Asia, bring it somewhere else and hide it far away from their oil routes and their bauxite routes, because our country is too strategically located. They have made that argument. But I think also that we need to see this in the context of the fact that this present American administration and the ruling circles in the United States today are totally and completely opposed to any revolution or to any progressive movement in any part of this region at all. And that is one of the reasons also why they have placed
Cuba, Nicaragua, and Grenada so high up on their hit list for extermination because they believe they have a right to rule the region, a right to rule the world, a right to tell other countries in this region how they must develop their own countries, who they must have be friends with, what policies they must be allowed to follow. They believe that they have this right, and therefore that is certainly another big factor in terms of the reason that this United States administration has shown so much hostility and has now decided finally that the time has come when they must move to remove us altogether by armed invasion.
I say, Maurice, you join politics to help people, but some people join politics to feather the cap. So forget about this damn politics. He said his mind is made up. He's not giving up.
Hey, CaribbeanInsightTV.com fans. Thanks for checking out our mini-series, Maurice Saw Them Coming. Coming up next, Acts Against the Revolution. Remember to hit the subscribe button to keep the culture coming.